Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this part two where we're going to go into the kind of the weeds a little bit in terms of understanding standing wave ratio. We'll also, what I have done, I've quickly put together a Yagi or directional antenna that's arrived. This is an antenna made by Arrow Antennas. I just happened to do a search. It seemed to have good reviews. It's made for UHF, and I'm hoping that it's going to give me both better ears and throw of my signal in terms of repeating DMR repeaters that are further away. Now, as it so happens, just prior to filming this video, I had a chat with some other hams on some local FM repeaters, and they told me of some other DMR repeaters which are far closer. There's one in Medina, which is about 22 miles away, and I've just been able to receive a signal from that. Now, as far as I know, I think it is connected to the rest of the kind of worldwide repeaters as well. That's something I still need to discover. But we're still going to experiment. I'm going to mount this on the roof at some point. We're going to take measurements and see what benefits something like a directional antenna has. And at the end of this video, I'll go into a very quick overview how a directional antenna has better gain through this kind of design. But anyway, let's jump into the standing wave ratio and impedance matching. Now, one of the basic challenges that we face when we're trying to hook up a radio to an antenna system is that we're trying to get all that kind of radio wave or that radio wave energy to pass from the radio through our transmission lines or cables and out through the antenna. Now, one of the problems that we face is that if we don't match up our radio with our antenna system properly, that energy doesn't all just go out through the antenna. We actually end up with a situation where the energy can start bouncing back and forth inside our antenna system and cable. So that's what we're going to have a look at. So in this very high level analogy, and I just want to highlight that often analogies can sometimes oversimplify what's going on, but I kind of want a very simple high level explanation for those who have no experience with this, just to give them an idea. And so here in this diagram, what I've got, this is a water pump, and it's got a little impeller which kind of swings round, which is kind of giving a pulsed pump of water into this pipe. And the idea is it's supposed to be pulsing this water out, pushing it out through this pipe and out through this vertical sprinkler, which has got holes in it. And that represents our antenna. So what we're hoping is that the pump is going to kind of pulse this water out, and it's going to be spurting out of this antenna. One of the key things you're going to hear when we're talking about radios and antenna systems is an impedance matching. So this impedance matching is basically like trying to ensure that we've got hooking up the right outlet size from that pump. So you're going to have an outlet where the water comes out, and you're going to have the pipe that you're going into, which is an inlet. And what you're trying to do is match those up so that you get the proper flow of water or your RF energy that's going to go through the pipe and straight up out to the antenna. If we have a mismatch in the pipe sizes with it, when we're trying to push that water, what potentially might happen is the water is going to go through and bounce back along the pipe. So let's just go through this in a little more detail. So if we've got this impeller pipe and it's trying to kind of pulse the water out, those impedances, now impedance is measured in ohms, and it's like resistance, but it's resistance that's dependent on frequency, and there's some certain components which affect that. Now, a pure resistor will have the same resistance in ohms at DC and other frequencies. However, when you start introducing inductors, so that's coils or capacitors, their resistance will change according to the frequency. And so they are said to have reactants. They react to different frequencies. Now, when you combine your capacitive reactance and your inductive reactance with your resistance, that is then impedance at a certain frequency. Now, on your line here, you're not necessarily going to have capacitors and inductors, but because you've got some wires close together and things coiled, they act as inductors and capacitors. So here on this kind of water pipe, what I've done here, I've got a container with a bladder or a balloon. And the reason this bladder or balloon is contained in this kind of bucket is because if once you fill up a capacitor, it's eventually going to be full and it's going to be contained in this bucket. Now, if we're passing purely DC through here, that capacitor would fill up and eventually block the DC. But with a pulsed AC signal, what you're going to have, that capacitor is going to fill up, and then the direction of the energy flow is going to change, and it's going to release its energy when it changes through the pulse cycle. Likewise, over here, I've got this kind of more rubberized springy pipe at the end here, which is to portray or show an inductor. And what happens there, an inductor, when you start pushing AC through it or energy into it, it has a magnetic field, which is going to, or a magnetic flux, which is going to contain its energy in this magnetic flux, which is going to grow and then collapse. And that collapsing of the flux passes electrical energy back out of it again. So you have both these components which potentially can start throwing energy back and forth between each other. And that's what's happening in this pipe and sprinkler system. When we have these inductors and capacitors and you're kind of pulsing this energy through here, and let's say you've got a restriction like over here, like we've got a washer or some restriction in the pipe, you could potentially can have a situation where you pulse this energy out, but some of it goes into that capacitor, some goes into the inductor, some gets squirted out through your sprinkler or your antenna. But then those collapse and they push it back down the pipe towards the pump. And you can have this situation where, because you don't have things correctly matched, you have this water sloshing back and forth. Now, that's not necessarily the end of the earth. It's not an ideal situation, but eventually, as it sloshes back and forth with this pump kind of pulsing energy back and forth, eventually it will go out of the sprinkler system. However, if you have losses, which is for the most part what we're going to have in our cabling systems, those losses, if you have a resistive component in your cabling, that energy will be turned into heat and lost. And likewise here, if we've got that restriction, I could easily represent that on this pipe by, let's say, you've got a small little hole or pressure point. And if there's a restriction and pressure, you're going to get water leaking out of your pipe. So if it sloshes back and forth too much, you're going to lose that water or energy, and it's not going to end up going out of your sprinkler system or your antenna. And that's kind of a very high level analogy of what we're faced with when we're connecting a radio system to a coaxial or a transmission line and up into an antenna. So one of the things that was discovered when amateur radio folks were using ladder line. Now, ladder line is basically two pieces of bare wire with an insulator. It could be a piece of wood holding them apart, which is why it looked like a ladder. They discovered that if they ran a light bulb connected between the two bare wires, that sometimes that light bulb would glow brighter and then less bright as they moved it along that ladder line. Its brightness would change, and they realized they had differing voltages along that line. And this is what brought around the realization that you had an unbalanced voltage going across that line, or a standing wave. So how is that standing wave developed? And this is a standing wave that we talk about in the standing wave ratio. Well, if we kind of now look at this as more of an electrical system, and you've got this energy or wave going out, but it's being reflected back because you don't have matched impedance, you have this wave being reflected back. And down here, if I represent it over here, we've got the sine wave. The blue one is the wave going forward. So that's the energy you're trying to push out of your antenna. But it reaches the end of your line, let's say, and because you've got inductance and capacitance and the energy bounces back along the line, you then have this return wave coming back. And those two waves, you've got one going forward, one going back. And if you think of a pond, if you have two ripples which come together and meet, they amplify, they combine, and they form a higher wave than just their own size. So as these waves come past each other, at some points they combine and form a bigger wave, and at some points they've got lower nodes or lower points, they'll create a lower dip, and that ends up being the standing wave. So here we can see we get two points of the wave, which at a point, if you sum them, combine to form a higher voltage point there, and at some points they're going to form a lower voltage point. And that wave actually stays in that position because you've got these other transitioning waves flowing back and forth past each other, and they create the standing wave. And that's where these earlier amateur radio enthusiasts, when they're passing a bulb along that wire, they'd move along and they'd hit this high point, the bulb would glow brighter. they'd move further along the ladder line, and then it would dim because you've got a low point, and then it would go high. And that was that standing wave. Now, ideally, a ham doesn't want the situation where you've got reflected waves, because what happens is if you have these waves bouncing back and forth, in theory, although they will eventually radiate out of the antenna, if you have any meaningful resistance or loss in your cabling system, eventually that bouncing back and forth, the energy is diminished and lost in heat. Now, fortunately, with these ladder line systems, they were very low loss. So what they, even though they had these issue with the standing waves, they realized that it didn't seem to affect the reception that much. And it's because they had such low loss in their cables that they still managed to get most of the energy out of the antenna system to be received by a receiver. So let's dig a bit deeper into some of the math and now calculating that standing wave. A very simple formula for this standing wave ratio, and you'll also see this noted as VSWR, voltage standing wave ratio. Now, there's not just voltage, there's current as well. And when we get onto the next board, I'm going to explain how this is very similar to something else I've spoken about in a previous tutorial. But to calculate that standing wave ratio, we simply take Vmax, so the maximum voltage value of that standing wave, and divide it by Vmin, the lowest value of the standing wave. And that then gives a ratio, which gives us an indication of how much reflected energy we've got going back through our transmission line and potentially our antenna. Okay, so now we're going to look at a more real-world example. We still don't want to get too bogged down by the maths. The mathematics of this can get rather complicated, because when you start looking at impedances, we start looking at complex numbers, and complex numbers have got a real component and an imaginary component. And that can get tricky if maths isn't your strong point. But what we're trying to do here, let's say, like, for instance, on my bench, I've got this radio. It's a UHF radio. It's spec to put out about 40 watts. Ideally, when I key down my PTT, I would like to see all of that 40 watt signal traverse that transmission line and exit my antenna so that I'm getting the full power going out. Now, you'll see what I'm going to start talking about, as opposed to that voltage standing wave radio, we're going to start talking about power. Now, the impedance value which has been decided on is 50 ohm. And what we're trying to do, like I said, we're trying to kind of match up the outlet of that pump to the pipe and sprinkler system. We're trying to match the impedance of our radio, which is 50 ohm, to our wiring system and antenna. And most of our wiring, if we're using coax, is about 50 ohm. Our antennas, ideally with the coax, you want to have an impedance there that is seen by the radio of 50 ohm, so that you've got this match. Now, when you have this match, mathematically, that's when you're going to get your best power transfer without any reflections. And if you do the calculation of your power that's being reflected, or your voltage that's being reflected, if everything is working properly and you've got a proper transfer of your power from your radio out through your antenna system without any reflections, that's an SWR of 1, or 1 to 1. Sometimes it'll be expressed as 1 to 1, or let's say 1.5 to 1. Sometimes people just say it's a standing wave ratio of 1, or a standing wave ratio of 1.5. Ideally, what people are aiming for is an SWR of 2 or less, so 2 to 1 or less. So let's talk about this 50 ohm impedance. Why 50 ohm impedance? Well, in an ideal world, mathematically, believe it or not, 50 ohm is not the ideal impedance. There are some other impedance levels depending on the system, but around 30 to 36 ohm or 70 to 75 ohm are the ideal impedances. But just after World War II, when materials became available to develop coax, the materials at hand combined to form cables of around 50 ohms. So that was adopted as a standard then. So why coax over ladder line? Well, as I've described, you've got bare lines with big insulators between it, and that's not an ideal cabling system if I want to run a cable out from my radio through the wall, up the roof to my antenna. Coax is far more convenient. Now, you get different types of coax. You get this thin, noodly stuff, which I'm using at the moment, and you get the nice, thicker stuff, which has got lower loss. And that becomes important, as I've kind of described in the other analogy and here. but that's where the 50 ohm comes from. So let's just talk about again impedance. Impedance is often represented as Z, and as I've said, that impedance, which is resistance related to frequency, so it's measured in ohms, but impedance changes with respect to frequency as frequency changes. So that impedance is made up of any normal real resistance, which is not affected by frequency. So you can see I've got an F here with a cross through it because pure resistance is not frequency dependent. We then have reactance. So we've got XC. So X is reactance. XC stands for capacitive reactance. That is frequency dependent. And then we've got XL. That's inductive reactance. And that is also frequency dependent. Because as I said, those components react with a changing pulse in energy or an AC waveform, and their resistance to a signal is going to change with the frequency of that signal. So now if we look at more of a real world system, so what I've done here, I've now got a little diagram with my radio that's on the bench. We've got some UHF connectors, PL259s, which connect into the back of the radio. I've got an antenna switch, which allows me to switch different radios into my antenna, or the other way around, you could have different antennas switch between different antennas into your radio. There's going to be a resistive component with that switch and potentially the connectors. With those and your transmission line, you're going to have inductance and capacitance, and then you've got your antenna system. Now, as I demonstrated in part one, where I've got that meter, and that meter showed me three measurements. It showed me my forward power, it showed me my SWR, my standing wave ratio, it did the calculation, it also showed me reflected power. So on that radio, as an example, so let's say for instance my radio happens to have about 40 watts, and on that meter I can see that I'm pushing out 38 watts into my antenna system. And that meter then showed me that I actually didn't have a perfect antenna system, and that I was getting 5 watts reflected back towards my radio. So we've got our power going forward and our power being reflected. So here, if you're dealing with power and you're trying to calculate your SWR, the formula is 1 plus the square root of your power reflected divided by your power forward, all divided by 1 minus the square root of your power reflected divided by your power going forward. And if you insert the numbers that I've used here as an example into that equation, you're going to come out with an answer that's approximately 2.1. So either 2.1, or it can be noted as 2.1 to 1. And that is your standing wave ratio. So we're going to come back and talk about this SWR of 2.1 and whether it's good or bad, or whether we've got the correct reading, because there are a few gotchas here. But the other thing I just want to talk about is something called series resonance. So ultimately what we're trying to do is when we're trying to match our system, so you can see I've got the radio here, and I'll just highlight that the one thing about this matching the radio, more modern radio design will actually look and have a look at the standing wave ratio. I've seen conflicting points of view on this on the web, but generally, the thing you need to be aware about is if you've got a bad standing wave ratio, which means you've got a lot of reflected power coming back towards your transmitter, you can potentially blow the final electronics on your transmitter. So you don't want too much energy coming back towards your transmitter, bouncing back and forth. So what modern radios will do, if they see a lot of reflected power, they'll actually start what they call folding back their power. They will reduce the power level so that they're not in risk of having too much or a high level of reflected power, which might cause damage. And of course, that's a problem, because if you've got less power coming out of your radio, you're going to end up with less coming out of your antenna. So that's why we certainly want to create a match so that our radio sees a reasonably good impedance so that it doesn't fold back its power. But there is another catch to this, because even if we've got the full power coming out and we've got this impedance matching right next to our radio, there's still a catch as to whether we get all that power going out through our antenna. But if we talk about the series resonance, what we're trying to do when we're trying to match things here is get to a point where the components, the inductive reactance and the capacitive reactance, cancel each other out. So when we start adjusting values to create this match, what we're trying to actually do is create a resonance over here so that those reactances cancel each other out and our impedance is equal to our resistance. And that happens at a certain frequency once we get things matched up, once we get our inductor value or our capacitive value adjusted. And there are many ways of doing that. That's another whole video altogether in terms of matching networks and adding stubs into the line and what have you. But if we have a look at this little graph over here, I've got a little graph. On our y-axis is our impedance, and on our x-axis, we've got our frequency level. And over here, we've got a line which shows, let's say at a lower frequency, we've got this higher impedance. And then as we hit a point of resonance, our impedance starts hitting a low point. And when we hit that resonance at frequency at that low point, that is when our impedance is equal to our resistance, because the capacitive reactance and the capacitive inductance will actually equal and cancel each other out. And then we only left with our normal resistance, and that is when we're going to get our voltage and our current in phase. I'm going to come back and say something about that, and that means we're going to get our power at its maximum. That's when we get our maximum power transfer. And this graph is interesting to view because this is the type of graph you're going to see on an antenna analyzer. Those antenna analyzers are really helpful for troubleshooting SWR or trying to help you when you're making adjustments to those components, whether it's with an antenna tuner or literally making adjustments with a coil or capacitors, to get this resonance at the frequency that you want to operate at. And that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to transmit with your radio at a certain frequency. And at that frequency, because we know that impedance is dependent on frequency, you want resonance at that point so that you can get the maximum transfer out through to your antenna system. So now let's talk about a real world catch. If I put a meter over here like I did with my radio in part one, and I measure the SWR right here at my radio, and we saw it's got a measurement of one, does that mean I've actually got a measurement of one? Well, no. And here's the catch. Potentially what can happen, I could actually have a very high standing wave ratio and reflections in my transmission and antenna system. But if I've got really thin, noodly cable like I've got buttered connections, I've got lots of PL259 connectors, I've got an antenna switch, these could be causing so much loss that I have, let's say, a 38 watt power going out up here. I could have a lot of that reflected, but it's being lost in all the losses in my cable system. And by the time the reflected wave reaches my meter, there's almost nothing there. So it doesn't look like I'm getting a reflection back. And hence, it looks like I've got a low SWR. And that's the little catch. What it does mean, though, is if I have a low SWR over here, whether it's due to losses or a good matching of my antenna system, it does mean that my radio system is going to be putting out maximum power, which is the first thing we want. But ideally, what we want to do is actually perhaps measure our SWR right at the end of our transmission cable, right at our antenna. That is where we're going to see, before the reflected wave gets lost in our transmission cable, what the maximum reflected power is. And that's where we're going to get a better true understanding of our SWR, is right near our antenna. So that is something I intend to do, if the weather allows, is to get up on the roof soon when I go install that new antenna, is to actually take the meter up there to see what my true SWR is after it's gone through all these bits and pieces. Now, as noted, what you can do, so we can take the measurement, and what you can get is an antenna tuner. So here we go. Here in my hands, I've got an antenna tuner. This is for HF frequencies, not for kind of UHF or VHF. And there's an important note about that. And these dials and knobs will allow you to adjust inductance values and capacitor values. And here I've got a dual needle meter, which will show you your forward power and your reflected power. And if you look at this, where they intersect, you'll actually directly get an SWR reading. So this is an analog version of that digital meter that I was using. So this is what we use, and for convenience, what we do is we place these antenna tuners right near the radio, because that's the easiest place to have it. But as I've noted, so what you're doing here is you're aligning and tuning this, and the tuning is a dangerous word because you're not necessarily tuning your whole antenna system. People call them antenna tuners, but you're not tuning your antenna. You're just merely impedance matching a point over here so that your radio sees a good impedance, or the right impedance, 50 ohm. So you'd put this here and you tune it if you do have an issue so that your radio sees a good SWR. But going behind your antenna tuner, you could still have all these reflections. And if you've got high resistive losses in your cables and connectors, that means you're going to lose that energy and it's not going to exit your antenna system. So ideally what you want to do, there are a couple of approaches. For one is to take your SWR readings as close to your antenna as possible to see what's going on there. And if you need to make adjustments, is to perhaps have a tuner right at the end of your antenna system so that your impedance is correct right along your antenna system and you haven't got these reflections going through your antenna system. And if you've got losses here, then you're losing a lot of energy. In an ideal world, you actually don't want an antenna tuner. What you want to do is tune your antenna. And that you can do by, often they can have a screw at the end, you change the length. On this Yagi antenna, there's a little element that you can move in and out to change its tuning, because once you've got the antenna tuned, now you've got a complete system that's in harmony. You've got matching from your radio and through your transmission system to your right to your antenna. What's the catch with that? If you've tuned your antenna, you've potentially now tuned to one frequency or a very narrow band of frequencies. And that's a limitation with having a system like that. Unless you can actually remotely tune your antenna from your ham shack somehow. Now, I personally don't know of systems like that. I'm sure they must be out there. But that's ideally what you want to do. But of course, that's not always practical. So that's why we end up with these antennas closer to our radios or at this kind of the end of our transmission line. So let's just have a quick look at this Rig Expert. As noted, this one only goes up to 200 megahertz, but the antenna that I've got attached is a dual band antenna. It's both a VHF and a UHF antenna. So I can test it with this. I'm just going to power this on. This allows you, it'll actually show you an impedance or where your antenna is resonant, or it can show you the SWR. It shows you a fair bit. We'll just do a quick check of the SWR. Apologies for the reflections, we'll try and keep that out. So here I've got it set at 145.4 megahertz, and if I go and push the OK button, it'll now actively show me the SWR. But remember, as I said, although this SWR looks good, and this is reflecting what the little power meter here was showing, although this was at UHF rather than here where we had VHF, this might be looking good because a lot of the reflected waves are not being seen because they're being lost due to the resistance in my cabling and all the rest of the bits and pieces. But nonetheless, this is what this can do. If we go back and have a look at the menu system, we can go and do a scan for SWR. Now this is the really useful part. So I'm going to push number 4. We then get this graph, and what we can do, so this is a graph which shows me my SWR over here. So we've got an SWR of up to 10 and right down to 1 on the bottom line here. And what I can do is I've got little cursors which are out of view now, but I can adjust the frequency. You can see the frequency changing where I kind of want it to center. And if I push the OK button, it now does a scan right across a frequency range which I've got in here. And you can see this nice dip. And this is our point of resonance. So that's where our capacitive reactance and inductance reactance are going to cancel each other out. And we've got this nice sharp little curve down there. And what this also allows us to do, so I can literally go and scan across now that it's done that scan. When I move this pointer over here, I can see at this frequency roughly what my SWR is going to be. So I can tell, let's say I may say, right, it's acceptable for me to operate up to an SWR of 2. And I can note what the frequency ranges or the band is there. On this, I can reduce the kind of frequency where it's going to scan. I can then do another scan. There, I reduce the range too much. I can move up and center over there. If I want to go closer, do another scan, which is now going to center around here. And using a tool like this, I can understand what kind of range I can operate in to maintain an SWR of, let's say, 2 or whatever my choice is. Or I can use this and make adjustments with an antenna tuner or on an antenna. And I've got another video where I go through the process of building an antenna and I kind of snip pieces of wire off the antenna until I get it tuned to my frequency of choice. And that's where one of these analyzers is very helpful. Now, the one thing I just want to highlight is that these are very sensitive. You mustn't have any transmitter switched on or anything like that when you are operating this, because if you have any pulse or too much power going back into this, it'll blow it. I was once using this with that antenna tuner and I was changing the kind of capacitive side. And when you change the capacitive side, you can actively see how this changes. And then I went and switched the inductor, and that by switching the inductor, there was obviously a big pulse of energy and it blew this unit and I had to send it back to be repaired. So that's just something to be aware of. Right, so before we end off, let's just quickly talk about this kind of Yagi or directional antenna that I've got. Now this one, I say I've got no affiliation with Arrow antennas. I just happened to look them up and they seem to have good reviews. This one is the model 445S. 5 denoting, I think, the number of elements on there, and 440 because this is a UHF antenna. So why have I got this? Well, as I noted that potentially prior to me just starting this video and realizing that there are some DMR repeaters that are about 20 miles away, which I seem to be receiving, I've still got a bit of playing around to do there, I'm still up for the challenge of trying to reach this repeater that's across Lake Erie, the one in Leamington, the one in Ontario, Canada. So to do that with the hopefully close to 40 watts, depending on what I'm getting out of my antenna, which is going to be another exercise, we're going to go through, you're going to come with me through the process of troubleshooting, making mistakes, seeing whether I get my transmission line, how much power I'm getting out, and then try to see if I can get a signal right across the water. So how is this going to work better than my vertical antenna? Well, that vertical antenna is sending radio waves out as long as it's not being affected by anything metallic or the earth nearby. And this is where antennas become complex, because if you've got elements nearby, they can affect the radio field and how it transmits. The one challenge with vertical antennas is that you're feeding them from the end. They're not balanced. Dipoles are antennas where you're sending out the signal into two halves of an antenna, and it's a balanced antenna system. Whereas a vertical, you're feeding it just straight from the bottom all up. And you're going to get signal which comes down and can interact with the earth, literally Mother Earth, that the soil on the ground. And if you don't have a good earth, which generally speaking, if you're in a neighborhood or whatever, the earth isn't going to be very inductive, you're going to have huge losses. And a vertical antenna near the earth might not operate well at all. And that's where you start getting people putting out radials, many radials to try and prove the earth. Or for instance, if you have an antenna over salt water, of course salt water is far more conductive, then it can act as a good earth, and then you get far lower losses and good radiation of your signal. So there's a lot that can change the way the signal radiates, the angle that it radiates. If you have an angle that's too steep, the energy can go out of the ionosphere. Now we're talking about kind of more high frequency stuff rather than UHF or VHF. But one of the other things you can do, as opposed to your signal going kind of evenly around you, is let's say I've got a power limit because I cannot add an amplifier, but I want to improve my signal punch towards this repeater across the water, I can use a directional antenna like this. So how does this work? I don't want to get into the weeds on this. My experience with antennas is very limited, but basically what these antennas do, you're going to have a connection point over here. And when you connect in here, you're feeding the elements which are spaced specifically apart along this rail over here. And the way they're spaced is that when this transmits a wave, it is spaced so that the peak of the wave coincides from the wave that's coming from this element. And like with the standing waves, just like in a sea or in a pond, if you have two ripples coming together, those waves combine and amplify or have better gain, they're bigger. That's what's happening in this antenna. So these are spaced specifically so that the waves combine and have more gain rather than just acting by themselves going out. So that's all it is. There's no real amplifier here. It's electromagnetic science, if you will, combining. So what happens at the back here? So here's the kind of active antenna. Now this antenna or element at the back here acts as a reflector. So this one transmits out here and combines with these forward elements. Some of this, the signal also obviously comes back, but then is reflected by this antenna and comes forward and then combines with these waves. And that's where we get this directional antenna. Another analogy, a vertical antenna is like you with your ears. At the moment, your ears are fairly flat to your head. It's amazing. If you just try this exercise, get your hands, cup them, and really bend your ears round and turn your head. You'll realize that sounds behind you are being blocked out, and you amplify the sounds that you can hear in front of you. And likewise, this is going to have very good ears in the direction that it's pointing in. And another analogy with its transmission is if I'm talking with my voice, I don't have to raise my voice. If I simply just cap around it, it's amplified because you're condensing the sound waves, not going dispersing in a wide area, but condensing the sound waves like this. And that is exactly what this is doing. You're not putting more energy into it or amplifying. You're just merely using some nice science to combine the waves to give them further throw, further reach, and for it to hear better. And that's potentially what this is going to do. So at the moment, even though this has good reviews, I can't say whether it's going to be a good or bad antenna until I get it up there, mount it properly. Have to be careful because I know there's a wire mesh over the chimney where I'm going to mount it. I don't have the ability or don't want to mount it too high, but if I mount it too low near other bits and pieces, I could compromise its performance. And that's what we're going to play around with. But anyway, I hope with those analogies and some of the kind of basic technical stuff, it's given you some idea. This topic, if you go and search the internet, is very hairy. There's a lot of misunderstanding and people's with their own point of view of how it works, contradictory information. So there's a good chance I might have not got things 100% right. But there are some basic fundamentals hopefully you can take away, is that realize that just merely measuring your SWR, let's say at that radio, might give you a false sense of security that the rest of your transmission system is better. You need to know that perhaps you need to be able to measure it up closer to your antenna. And where you're using an antenna tuner, you're not necessarily correcting a problem with wave reflections or standing waves in your antenna system. You're merely presenting your radio with a good impedance at this point, so that your radio puts out the maximum power. But if you really want to get things right the rest of the way, then you're going to want to have your antenna tuner either closer to your antenna or tune your antenna. Or make sure that the coax that you're using has got low loss. That is one of the key things. You can afford to have a high SWR. You can have signals bouncing back and forth, which will eventually leave and go out through your antenna system, as long as they're not lost in heat because of losses in your cabling or your transmission system. So that's a key thing to take away. But anyway, we're going to put this into practice. And if there are any mistakes or what have you, please comment below, add good constructive comment to this, and come along and enjoy the journey with me in terms of trying to get my radio up and running. And hopefully this might help you if you're in a similar situation. But anyway, thanks very much for watching. If you gain any value, please give it a thumbs up. And I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.